As we give these messages.
Amen.
You know, even as the candlestick in the holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. And I was wondering, why is God impressing this particular... That goes completely in harmony with the message for this evening, so amen. But I was wondering why the Lord was impressing this particular message upon my heart to share with you this evening. And then as I heard the presentation that the Lord placed upon Brother Hakeem's heart to share, all things became clear.
Amen.
Amen. So before we get into the Word of God, as it is my tradition, I want to invite everyone to fall on your knees with me, if you are so inclined to do so. But nonetheless, I want to give you the opportunity to pray. I just want to give you 60 seconds to pray in your heart simply for the Spirit of God to move upon you and all of us as we gather here under the inspiration of the Lord. And I'll close in prayer. So let us go before God now in prayer. Father in heaven, I thank you, Lord, for the rich blessings that you've been imparting to us on this, your holy Sabbath day. I thank you for opening up the treasure house of wisdom and bringing forth things old and things new. And I do ask that all of the gems that you've revealed to us, that we will not allow the beauty of even that smallest, so to say, gem of truth that you've shown to us, that we would not allow any of that to escape us. My Lord, as the day is rapidly drawing to its close, we ask that you would continue to tabernacle here with us, and that the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, would continue to guide us into all truth, as you so promised that he would do. For you told us in your word, if our parents being evil know how to give good gifts unto their children, how much more would you, our Father which is in heaven, give the Holy Spirit unto them that ask him? And so shamelessly, Lord, continuously, we beg you for the Holy Spirit. Please, open thou our eyes that we might see and behold wondrous things out of thy law. And may we be transformed into your image from glory to glory, even as by your Spirit. Thank you for hearing this, our prayer. And again, I pray for myself. Please, Lord, cleanse my heart of all sin and self-righteousness and self-trust. Just purge me, Father, so that your word might proceed forth as you so design. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Open your Bible. this can go up just a little bit. I'm not going to hold it. Open your Bibles with me to the book of Peter. Chapter 2, familiar scripture. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. When you have it, say amen. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. When you have it, just say amen. Are you there with me? The Bible says this in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that he should show forth the praises of him who have called you out of darkness into his marvelous, what, brothers and sisters? So God says that we are a chosen generation, we're a holy people, and God has called us to show forth his praises unto a wicked and perverse generation. But how did he call us forth to show forth his praises? The Bible says that he called us out of the darkness into the marvelous light to accomplish this objective. Now go with me to the book of 2 Peter chapter 1. And let's look at verse 19, for the Bible shows us here how God calls a people out of darkness into the light. In the book of 2 Peter chapter 1, beginning at verse 19, will you have it, just say amen. The Bible tells us, we have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawns and the day star arises in our hearts. Now, brothers and sisters, the day star we know to be the what? The sun. Am I correct? The day star we know to be the sun. And so therefore, the Bible identifies symbolically the more sure word of prophecy as this light that shines in the darkness prior to the rising of the sun. Now, what light do you know that shines in the darkness prior to the rising of the sun? The moon, am I correct? The moon reflects the light of the sun, am I correct? The moon reflects the light of the sun, and it leads us, or keeps us, until we are able to see the glory of the sun in all of its fullness. And so the Word of God tells us that God uses the instrument of the more sure word of prophecy to guide a people out of darkness into the marvelous light of Jesus Christ. And there's an experience that all of us are supposed to undergo as we are following this light in the darkness, or rather this light that God has commissioned to shine for us while we're walking in the darkness to bring us fully into the marvelous light. And this experience is spoken of in the book of Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 18. Proverbs 4 and verse 18. Proverbs 4 and verse 18. And these are just a few foundational principles that I want us to have in our mind before we actually get into our subject matter for this evening. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 18. It's another very familiar scripture. When you have it, just say amen. Amen. The Bible tells us here, but the path of the just, the path of those that are justified in Jesus Christ, the path of those that have accepted the sacrifice of Jesus Christ as having the ability to cleanse them of their sins and keep them from falling, the path of the just is as the shining light. And this light shines more and more until what, brothers and sisters? The perfect day. And the perfect day that's being spoken of there is the time in which Jesus comes in the fullness of all of his glory. So there's an experience that God would have us to have with him on a daily basis. We are to be growing in the light. It's a path. It's a walk. It's the Enoch walk. The path of the just is as a shining light, and it shines more and more until we are able to actually stand in the presence of God in all of his glory. Well, remember, the Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, that our God is a what? Consuming fire. And so therefore, the more sure word of prophecy is the instrumentality that God has given unto us, that as we follow its leadership in our lives, or rather as we allow it to lead us, it will prepare us to stand in the presence of God without being consumed by his glory. With that in mind, I want you to turn with me to the book of Revelation chapter 6. Revelation, the sixth chapter. Revelation chapter 6, and we're going to go through the whole chapter. Revelation chapter 6, beginning at verse 1. The Bible tells us this. I'll allow you to catch up. The Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 6, beginning at verse 1, "And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, 'Come and see.' And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. And when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, 'Come and see.' And there went out another horse that was..." Come on, brethren, you have a Bible, I have a Bible. "There went out another horse that was..."
Right.
"And power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him" what?
"A
great sword. And when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, 'Come and see.' And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard a voice" from where? "In the midst of the four beasts say, 'A measure of wheat for a..." "And 3 measures of barley for a..." "And see, thou hurt not the oil and the wine." Now look at this. "And when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, 'Come and...' And I looked, and behold, a pale horse. And his name that sat on him was Death. And hell followed with him, and power was given unto him that..." "Power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with the sword, and with hunger, and with death, and with the beasts of the earth. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, 'How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not avenge our blood on what? On them that dwell in the earth.'" Look at verse 11. "And white robes were given unto every one of them. And it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season until their fellow servants and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled." Verse 12. "And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake. And the sun became black as sackcloth of hair. And the moon became as blood. And the stars of heaven fell, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heavens departed as a scroll when it is rolled together. And the mountains of the isles were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man did what? Hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said unto the mountains and rocks, 'Fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sitteth upon the throne,' and from where? The wrath of the Lamb, for the day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand?" Now, brothers and sisters, what we've just looked at in these 17 verses of Scripture is the entire history of the Christian church from the time that they entered the battlefield of the great controversy. Notice I say, from the time that the church entered the battlefield of the great controversy, and I say this because if you pay close attention, you'll notice very clearly that under the opening up of the first four seals, what type of creatures do you see proceeding out of them? Come on now. Do you see frogs or eagles?
Horses.
You see horses, amen? Go with me to Proverbs chapter 21. Proverbs chapter 21, let's look at verse 31. Proverbs 21 and verse 31. The Bible says in the book of Proverbs chapter 21 and verse 31, speaking of horses... Will you have it? Just say amen. The Bible tells us in Proverbs 21 and verse 31, "The horse is prepared against the day of battle, but salvation is of whom, brothers and sisters? The Lord." So the horse in the Bible is a symbol of battle. And so here we see, symbolically speaking, the church of the living God entering the battlefield of the great controversy. Under the first four seals, we see four different horses. Each one changed in their color, and the varying in the color is a varying in the character of the church under that seal. Do you understand what I just said?
Yeah.
In other words, the first seal, you have a white horse that proceeds out. We know that white in the Bible is a symbol of purity and righteousness. Clearly, there's a rider that's riding on top of this horse. He has a crown on top of his head. He has a bow in his hand. A bow and arrow, is that used for Hand-to-hand combat, or is that used for long-distance combat? So this is dealing with the far-reaching effects of the gospel under this white horse. We're told by the Apostle Paul that the gospel went to the then-known world under the time period of this first horse. We call this the apostolic church. Nonetheless, we go forward and we see this next horse, this second horse that's coming out of the second seal. And what color is it? No, it's not black. I'm going to let you use your Bibles. What color is it? It's red. Now, what is red a symbol of in the Bible? Red is a symbol of blood. Okay, red is a symbol of blood. That's truth. And what else? Persecution, truth. What else? What else? Okay, sin. Let's go to Isaiah 1 and verse 18 on that. Isaiah 1 and verse 18. Familiar scripture. I know most of us already know this one by heart. Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 18. Brothers and sisters, I'm asking you, put your thinking caps on this evening. We need to think as we go through this message. Amen?
Amen.
The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 18, are you there? Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, I will make them. Though they be red like crimson, I will make them as what? Wool. So red in the Bible can be a symbol of sin. Red in the Bible can be a symbol of persecution. And this is certainly dealing with the church during a time period that it went through the most fierce persecution that it ever experienced up until that date. In particular, under the reign of Diocletian from 303 BC all the way through 313 BC. Fierce persecution that the church underwent. But also, error began to enter into the ranks of God's church. Are you following me, brothers and sisters? Error began to enter into the ranks of God's church, which brings us unto the third seal, where we see this black horse. Now, when you think of black, what do you think of?
Death.
What do you think of?
Death
and darkness, am I correct? Notice that this rider has a pair of balances in his hand. The Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs, chapter 11 and verse 1. Go there with me quickly. Proverbs 11 and verse 1. And we're just moving quickly through these verses of scripture because this is not the point of interest that we're really going to be focusing in on this evening. But nonetheless, it's imperative that we go through this so that we can have somewhat of a foundation that will bring us up to the point that we want to investigate. In Proverbs chapter 11 and verse 1, are you there? The Bible says this, a false balance is what?
Abomination
to the Lord, but a just weight is his delight.
Amen.
And that's what happened, brothers and sisters. Justice was being perverted in the church of the living God. There was this union, this compromising that was taking place between the church and the world at that time. And yet there was a voice that came from the midst of the four beasts. And according to the book of Revelation chapter 4, that voice can only be the voice of God himself. For God is the one that sits in the midst of the four beasts, for it is the four beasts that carry the throne of the living God. And he made a declaration, see thou hurt not the oil and the wine. And if I can just say this in the simplest language, God said, protect my truth. Even though men are bringing error in, even though they're perverting righteousness, my truth will remain protected. Which brings us now to the fourth seal, and we see a pale horse riding out of it. The rider's name is Death. How does death come about into existence? Or how does death come into existence?
Sin.
Bible says in book of Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, the wages of sin is
death.
So the rider's name is death. Can we not say that the rider's name is sin? Come on, brother, follow with me. Can I not say that the rider's name is sin?
Yes.
So there's a man of sin riding on this horse.
Yes.
And hell follows with them. What is hell, brothers and sisters? Absolute perdition and destruction. Now, do you know of a power that's called the man of sin that brings perdition and destruction in his train? According to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, beginning at verse 3, it is none other than the Antichrist, the Bible prophecy, the same papal power that my brother dealt with in detail just moments ago. And so what we're looking at under the fourth seal is the reign of the papacy from 538 AD all the way through 1798 AD. And I said BC earlier, I meant AD, praise the Lord, amen. From 538 AD all the way through 1798 AD, this time period in which the papacy was reigning, and notice that it was giving people over to destruction by hunger, by beasts of the field, by the sword. All of these things, they transpired, brothers and sisters. History makes it very clear. But then as we come to the fifth seal, we see under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And brothers and sisters, this is just speaking in a very symbolic sense. Even as the righteous blood of Abel continues to cry from the ground, this is dealing with the voices of the martyrs still being heard by God himself. The martyrs that were martyred by the power that was under the fourth seal, the papacy, the man of sin, they're saying, how long, O Lord, are you going to allow this power to continue to reign without receiving its just punishment? But then, God does not answer that question there, if you notice that. Not yet. The first thing he does is he gives them white robes. You said they went to graves as heretics. God says, no, they were my righteous saints. And he says, you must rest yet for a little season until your fellow servants and your brethren that should be killed like as you were should be fulfilled. Brothers and sisters, that's talking about a people that are going to be martyred the same way that God's people were martyred back then in the dark ages from 538 to 1798. We're talking about an event that is going to take place in the near future. And it could be many of us here under this tent right now that will suffer that martyr's death. No, 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 brothers and sisters. You better be trying to shoot for the 144,000. But then after this scene, we see something else. When the sixth seal opens up, there was a great earthquake. That was the earthquake of Lisbon, happened in the year 1755. Are you with me? The sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. That happened in the year what? Does anybody know? 1780, the great dark day. Mark it on your calendar. And then the stars of heaven fell, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. When did that happen? That happened in the year 1833. Now, I want you to look closely at your Bibles with me. Revelation chapter 6. Revelation chapter 6. Just look at verse 14, I believe it is. Revelation chapter 6, beginning at verse 14. Are you there with me? Just say amen. Amen. The Bible says this, and the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and isle were moved out of their places, and the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every freeman hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains. And basically, brothers and sisters, without going any further, they were saying, hide us, because judgment is coming. Because they saw that Jesus was coming. After the event spoken of the stars of heaven falling in 1833, the very next prophetic events that are spoken of in the Bible in Revelation chapter 6, beginning at verse 14, are the events that act as the harbingers or the signs that the second coming of Jesus Christ is right at hand. Now, the reason why this is so important for us to take note of is because Revelation chapter 6 is a book that is in total chronological order. Did you hear that? Each one of these seals open and close in chronological order. In other words, the first seal opens up, the first seal closes. In the very same year, very same day, very same hour, second seal opens up. There is no gap in time that elapses. When the second seal opens and the second seal closes, same year the third seal opens up. There is no elapse in time. Are you following what I'm saying right now? However, when you get down to the sixth seal, the very last event we see is the stars of heaven falling, even as a fig tree when it casts its untimely figs, when it's shaken of a mighty wind, 1833. And then we see the events that foreshadow the second coming of Jesus Christ. Now, question. Is the second coming of Jesus Christ a past event or a future event? How long ago was 1833? Trust me, I'm enjoying this more than you are.
Close to 200 years ago,
amen? Close to 200 years ago, 1833 took place. Brothers and sisters, the second coming of Jesus Christ is a future event. It is almost as if God has left us, his church, in the dark as to what events would transpire involving his church in the great controversy from 1833 up until the second coming of Jesus Christ. Now, do you think God has left us in the dark? The answer clearly is what?
No.
But let's see what God's message is for us right there in Revelation chapter 6. Go with me to Matthew chapter 24. Matthew, the 24th chapter. Matthew, the 24th chapter. Let's begin at verse 29. Matthew chapter 24, beginning at verse 29. I'm going to take this slow, but I want you to see it. When you have it, just say amen. The Bible says this in Matthew 24, beginning at verse 29. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heaven shall be what? Now, brothers and sisters, did we see these very same signs in the book of Revelation chapter 6 under the sixth seal? Yes? Now, let's go further. Verse 30. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with the great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. Pay close attention to the next verse. Now learn a parable of the what? When a branch is yet tender, and put it forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh. So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the... Go with me now to Mark chapter 13. Mark chapter 13, let's begin at verse 24. Mark chapter 13, beginning at verse 24. When you have it, just say amen. Mark the 13th chapter, beginning at verse 24. Look what the Bible tells us here. But in those days after that tribulation, the sun shall be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light. Same sign we saw in Revelation chapter 6.
Amen.
Verse 25. And the stars of heaven shall fall. Same thing in Revelation 6. And the powers that are in heaven shall be shaken, and then shall they see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory, and then shall he send his angels. And they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from the uttermost part of the earth to the uttermost part of... Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When a branch is yet tender and put it forth leaves, ye know that summer is near. So ye in like manner, we shall see all these things come to pass, know that it is nigh, even at the... Now go with me to Luke chapter 21. Luke the 21st chapter, we're going to begin at verse 25. Luke chapter 21, beginning at verse 25. When you have it, just say amen. Luke 21 and verse 25, the Bible begins by saying this. And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and on the earth what? The stress of nation with perplexities, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts filling them for fear, and what else? Which are coming upon the earth, for the powers that are in the heaven shall be
shaken.
And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth. Verse 29, don't miss it now. And he spake to them a parable. Behold the fig tree and all the trees. When they now shoot forth, ye see, and know of your own selves that summer is now nigh at hand. So likewise ye, when ye see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is what? In Matthew chapter 24, Mark chapter 13, and here in Luke chapter 21, we see all of the exact same signs that you see under the sixth seal in Revelation chapter 6. And every time you see these signs that foreshadow the second coming of Jesus Christ, Jesus always presents in connection with them a fig tree. Didn't you see that? Every time he says, learn the parable of the fig tree. You know when you see of yourself the fig tree. Even in Revelation chapter 6, when you see the very last sign that transpires in 1833, it says the stars of heaven fell, even as a fig tree. Casteth its untimely figs when it's shaken up a mighty wind. Brothers and sisters, what's the deal with the fig tree? Because it's evident there's something important about the fig tree. There is no way that God would continuously show the symbol of the fig tree, not once, not twice, not thrice, but four times in connection with the same events if there's not something important about this fig tree. Now, what is a fig tree a symbol of in the Bible? Go with me to Luke chapter 13. Luke the 13th chapter. Father in heaven, I pray as we go through your word that your Holy Spirit will grant us clarity of mind and that you would impress these truths upon our hearts. That it will not just be theoretical, O Lord, but you will pierce us to the very depths of our souls. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible says in the book of Luke chapter 13, are you there with me? Luke the 13th chapter, we're going to begin at verse 1. Luke chapter 13, beginning at verse 1. Well, I thank God for the wind. I thank God for the object lessons right now, brothers and sisters. You never forget this message, amen? The Bible says in Luke chapter 13, beginning at verse 1, there were present at that season some that told him of the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And Jesus answering said unto them, suppose ye that these Galileans were sinners above what? All the Galileans, because they suffered such things, I tell you, nay. But except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Or those 18 upon whom the Tower of Siloam fell and slew them all, think ye that they were sinners above all men that dwelt in Jerusalem? I tell ye, nay. But except ye repent, the Bible tells us, ye shall all likewise perish. Verse 6. He spake also this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard. And he came and saw fruit thereon, and found how much? None. Then said he unto the dresser of his vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking for fruit on this fig tree, and find how much? Cut it down, why cumbereth it the ground? And he answering said unto him, let it alone, Lord, no. Let it alone this year also, till I shall dig it about and dung it. And if it bear fruit, well, and if not, then afterward thou shalt cut it down. Brothers and sisters, what was that fig tree a symbol of? Come on now, you know what the fig tree was a symbol of. Do I? You don't remember what the brother said earlier. Are you a disciple or are you a part of the multitude? Now this parable should not be too hard for you to understand. What was that fig tree a symbol of? The fig tree was a symbol of God's people. In particular, if you look at the time frame that was allotted unto this fig tree, you'll learn something very significant. The owner of the vineyard said, these 3 years, I come seeking for fruit on the fig tree and I don't find any. But then the dresser of the vineyard goes to the owner of the vineyard and says, hold on, let it alone for one more year. Let me dig it about, let me dung it. According to the prophecy in the book of Daniel chapter 9 concerning the Messiah. Let's go there, because I see the deer in the headlight look on your face, some of you. Go with me to Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9. When you're there with me, say amen. Daniel chapter 9, we're going to look at verse 27. Daniel 9 and verse 27, speaking of Messiah, look what the Bible says. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for how long? 1 week. And in the midst of the week, he shall what? Cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease. How did Christ cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease? How did he cause the sacrificial system to come to its cessation? By a sacrifice on the cross. His ministry was from the year 27 AD all the way to what? 31 AD, from the year 30 to 33, he did his work. Amen? For 3.5 years. Brothers and sisters, are you following? For 3.5 years, the owner of the vineyard and even the dresser, they were looking for fruit. What type of fruit? Come on, brethren, you know what type of fruit it was. Galatians 5 and verse 22. For the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. God was searching for fruit in his people. He healed, he preached, he pleaded, he even wept. No fruit. For 3 years, the owner was seeking for fruit. Give me another word for seeking, brothers and sisters. Come on now, help me out. Searching. Give me another word for searching.
Looking.
Give me another word for looking.
Observing.
Come on now. I'm searching. Really closely. I'm searching.
Digging.
I got a magnifying glass searching.
Digging.
Investigating. Listen to me closely. For 3.5 years, he was investigating his people. He was investigating his church. Searching for fruit. At the end of their probationary time period, when he saw no fruit, what happened? They were cut off as a people. He investigated that tree thoroughly, brothers and sisters. Go with me to the book of Matthew. Go with me to the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 20. I want you to see this one more time. Brothers and sisters, that fig tree is a symbol of God's church, but it's dealing with some important symbolism. Matthew chapter 21. Matthew the 21st chapter. And in Matthew chapter 21, you know that we have the instance where Jesus had the triumphal, his triumphant entry into Jerusalem. You remember this, don't you? They're taking down palms. Hosanna in the highest. We're throwing our garments in the road. Right? Well, shortly thereafter, Jesus steps outside of the walls of Jerusalem. Go with me to Matthew chapter 21, beginning at verse 18. Are you there? The Bible says this. Now in the morning, as he returned into the city, he did what? He hungered. And when he saw a fig tree in the way, he came to it and found nothing thereon, but leaves only, and said unto it, let no fruit grow on thee from henceforth forever. And presently the fig tree withered away. Brothers and sisters, Jesus was hungry. And in the distance, he saw a fig tree. And it was filled with leaves. Now, I'm from New York, but I'm now fully consecrated country boy.
Amen.
Now, let me tell you something about a fig tree, brothers and sisters. A fig tree bears leaves before it bears fruit. No, did I say that right?
No.
A fig tree bears fruit before it bears leaves. So if you see a fig tree filled with leaves, that means there's fruit on that fig tree. Because it's one of the only trees that I know that actually bears the fruit before the leaves. So Jesus sees these leaves and says, oh, looks like there's some fruit there. So he goes to this fig tree. And as the spirit of prophecy tells us, he searches from the highest bough to the lowest, seeking for what? But when he finds none, what does he do? He curses that tree. It is completely cut off. Notice every time this symbol of the fig tree comes up, God is investigating the fig tree. And when God doesn't find fruit on the fig tree, it gets cut off. Brothers and sisters, the fig tree is a symbol of God's people living under a time period of the investigating eye of God. And I'm here to tell you this evening, in Revelation chapter 6, when it says that the stars of heaven fell, even as a fig tree casteth its untimely figs when it's shaken of a mighty wind, I'm here to tell you that the Bible didn't just use the fig tree there as a good symbol of how the stars flew out of the heavens. That fig tree is dealing with his church. You don't believe me? Let's find out. The Bible says that the fig tree was shaken of a mighty wind. Am I correct? Am I right or wrong here? If you're not sure, go back to Revelation chapter 6. I want you to see this. Don't worry, I won't take long, brethren. But you will see this. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 6. Revelation chapter 6. And let's look at verse 13. When you're there, just say amen. And the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her what? When she is shaken off a mighty wind. Now, brothers and sisters, what is wind the symbol of in the Bible? Come on now, come on now. Somebody said Holy Spirit. Somebody said destruction, war, strife, commotion. What else? Anything else? Okay, let's prove these things. Let's go to, let's deal with strife, commotion, war. Let's look at several scriptures. Go to Daniel. Go to Daniel. Go to Daniel chapter 11. Daniel 11 and verse 40. Daniel 11 and verse 40. Will you have it? Just say amen. Daniel 11 and verse 40. When you have it, just say amen. Are you there?
Amen.
The Bible says this. And at the time of the end, the king of the shall push at him, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind with chariots and with horsemen and with ships. Let's just stop right there. So we see the whirlwind right here, and in connection with the whirlwind, we see chariots and horsemen and what else? And ships. This is clearly a scene of conflagration, a scene of strife and war and controversy, correct?
Yeah.
Go with me now to John chapter 3. John chapter 3, let's begin at verse 6. John 3, beginning at verse 6. Matter of fact, start at verse 7. John 3 and verse 7. When you have it, say amen. So, wind in the Bible can be a symbol of war or commotion or destruction, but we'll stay right there. John chapter 3, beginning at verse 7. When you have it, just say amen. The Bible says, marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be
born
again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh, and whither it so is everyone that is born of the
Spirit.
So wind in the Bible can also be a symbol of the operation of the Spirit of God.
Amen?
Amen? Amen. Go with me now to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4, we're going to verse 14. Ephesians rather 4 and verse 14. When you have it, just say amen.
Amen.
Are you there?
Amen.
Ephesians 4 and verse 14, the Bible says this. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, and carried about with every of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to do what? So we found out that wind in the Bible can be a symbol of war and commotion. Wind in the Bible can be a symbol of the operation of the Spirit of God. Wind in the Bible can also be a symbol of doctrine. Now watch me, I said wind can be a symbol of doctrine. Now in the immediate context of Ephesians 4 and verse 14, it's clearly talking about false doctrine. However, wind in the Bible must also be able to symbolize good doctrine. Why did I say that? Let's prove this from the Word of God. The Bible told us in the book of John chapter 3 verses 7 and 8 that a man is born again even as the wind bloweth where it listed, and you can't tell from whence it cometh or whither it goeth. Am I correct? Am I correct?
Yeah.
The Bible tells us also in the book of 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 20. You know this one. That's, matter of fact, let's just go to verse 1, verse 21. For the prophecy came not of old time by the will of men, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by what? The Holy Spirit. So that Word of God came through the instrumentality of the moving of the Holy Spirit. The Bible tells us in 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, in particular, inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Am I right?
Yes.
And it's profitable for doctrine. So when the Spirit of God moves upon a man's heart to bring about the new birth experience, he brings into our hearts pure doctrine.
Yes.
So that we might be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So wind in the Bible can be symbolic of war and commotion. Wind in the Bible can be symbolic of the working of the Spirit of God.
Conversion.
Say that again.
Conversion.
A virgin.
Conversion.
Conversion. The working of the Spirit of God, which does bring about conversion as well. Amen. And wind in the Bible can be symbolic of doctrine, correct?
Amen.
Now, brothers and sisters, listen closely. When the sixth seal opens up, the first event we see is an earthquake. What year did that happen in? 1755, the earthquake of Lisbon. The sun became black as sackcloth of hair. The moon became as blood. What year did that happen in? Come on now. 1780. Then the stars of heaven fell, even as a fig tree casteth its untimely figs when it's shaken of a mighty wind. What year did that happen in? But I've just shown you from the Bible that a fig tree can be a symbol of God's church under the investigating eye of God. I've also showed you that wind in the Bible can be a symbol of commotion, the moving of the Spirit of God, and doctrine. Am I correct? So now let me ask you a question. In the year 1833, was there a mighty doctrine that came through the instrumentality of the Spirit of God that dealt with a time period of an investigative judgment opening up on the people of God? Brothers and sisters, it was in the year 1833 that William Miller began to preach the first angel's message of Revelation chapter 14 and verse 7. Fear God and give glory unto him, for the hour of his judgment is come. Brothers and sisters, it was a mighty doctrine. It was a mighty wind. Oh, brothers and sisters, it was such a mighty wind. People started coming out of the established churches of that time. But if that doctrine all by itself wasn't mighty enough, it was coupled with the second angel's message of Revelation chapter 14 and verse 8. Babylon is falling. It's falling, that great city. But you made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Brethren, it was such a mighty doctrine. That doctrine was so mighty that it caused a moral downfall of the churches in America, which they have never rebounded from and they never will rebound from. The message was so powerful that it developed a group of 50,000 people that were looking anxiously towards the second coming of Jesus. It was a church that, it was a message that caused commotion amongst the churches. Brother, it caused absolute upheaval in the established churches of that time. But if it wasn't powerful enough all by itself, then the second angel's message was empowered by the midnight cry of Matthew chapter 25. The bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. What I'm sharing with you right now is the history of the Advent movement.
Amen.
The message was so powerful that when it finished doing its mighty work of shaking the fig tree, it shook a group of 50,000 all the way down to 50. Now, brothers and sisters, tell me, how powerful a doctrine is that? 50,000 and then you're left with 50. That's not even 1% standing. Not even 1% were able to stand the blowing of that wind. That came not by the instrumentality of man, but it came through the authority of the Spirit of God. Now, what I'm getting ready to share with you right now is the messenger of the Lord, Sister Ellen G. White's first vision that she received, in which she actually speaks of in symbol the events that unfolded under the proclamation of the first angel's message, the second angel's message, and the midnight cry. Brothers and sisters, I want you to pay close attention to what I'm getting ready to share with you. Because the Bible tells us in Ecclesiastes 3:15, that which hath been is now, and that which is to be hath already been, and God requireth that which is past. We are going to see a repetition of events that took place during the Millerite movement. And brothers and sisters, it's happening even now. I turned to look for the Advent people in the world, but could not find them. Oh, mercy. But could not find them. That's right. We just blow the trumpet today. Amen. Amen. But could not find them. When a voice said to me, look again and look a little higher. At this I raised my eyes and saw a straight and narrow path cast up high above the world. Brothers and sisters, she was looking for God's people. She looked left. She looked right. She looked north. She looked south. The angel said, no. You can't look those directions. You have to look up. And you have to look a little higher. God's people are not a people of this world, brothers and sisters. Because when she looked up higher, she saw a straight and narrow path cast up high above the world. And what we're going to find out very shortly from now is that that straight and narrow path that the Advent band were walking on is nothing more than the path of the just, of Proverbs 4 and verse 18. On this path, the Advent people were traveling to the city which was at the farther end of the path. They had a bright light set up behind them at the beginning of the path, which an angel told me was the midnight cry. What started their feet on this path that was leading them out of the darkness of the world into the New Jerusalem? What started them on that path? But brothers and sisters, what is the midnight cry? The midnight cry was nothing more and nothing less than the more sure word of prophecy. It was a prophetic message that made God's people detach themselves from the things of this life and begin their journey to the New Jerusalem. It says, this light shone all along the path and gave light for their feet so that they might not stumble. As long as they held on to the more sure word of prophecy, their feet were sure on the path. As long as they did not forget where God had led them from and how God had led them out. Don't miss what I just said. As long as they did not forget where God had led them from and how God had led them out, they were safe on the path. If they kept their eyes fixed on Jesus, the bright and morning star, who was just before them, leading them to the city, they were safe. But soon some grew weary and said the city was a great way off, and they expected to have entered it before. Surely the Sunday law would have come under Bush's administration. Surely under the first administration of Obama, surely we should have been out of this world a long time ago. Brothers and sisters, I never saw so many people in prayer meeting until this happened. I used to go to prayer meeting at this time of my life. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. There'd be five of us in prayer meeting. See, if we had eight, we had a full house. Wow. 9/11 hit. We had to put chairs in the aisles. People were stirred up. Oh, we see the events happening. See, we get agitated when we see something, right? When we fear for our lives, we get agitated. But when the cares of this life just continue to roll on. Oh, I thought that we would have entered a long time ago. Maybe it's just alarmism. Maybe it's not really what we thought it was. Maybe we're just going to go to our graves and we won't even see the event. Is that what some of us are saying right now? Or we're not saying it with our lips, but are our lives telling that? Are our lives saying, surely we thought we would have entered this city a long time ago? But I want you to see what Jesus does. As the people of God begin to get a little bit discouraged, then Jesus would encourage them by raising his glorious right arm, and from his arm came a light which waved over the Advent band, and they shouted, Hallelujah! You see, brothers and sisters, the path of the just is as a shining light, which shines more and more unto that perfect day. See, as we're traveling on this path, and at times we may become discouraged. That's all right. We don't need it anymore. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
As we're traveling along the path, we may become discouraged at times. And then Jesus says, oh no, my child. He raises the right arm. Amen. And he gives more light.
Amen.
To encourage us. To invigorate our experience so that we press forward, and then as we continue forward on the path of the just and discouragement may come again, he gives more light.
Amen.
Why? Because the path of the just is as a shining light that shines more and more as we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus.
Amen.
But brothers and sisters, as the quote goes on to say, it says some began to say that it could not have been the Lord that led us out this far. And they took their eyes off of Jesus, and the light went out that was behind them, and they fell off the path down into the dark world below. Brothers and sisters, what did they mean that it could not have been God that led us out this far? So far from where? So far from the world. How many of us are saying that? How many of us say it can't be God that's calling us to be so different? Come on, it can't be God that's telling us that we have to eat so differently. That we should dress so differently. What's wrong with showing a little flesh? Just as wrong as Adam and Eve tying up fig leaves. Wait. What type of leaves?
Fig leaves.
Just as wrong as God as them putting on aprons. What do you mean, what's wrong? What's wrong with eating this way? Come on, it's just too much. It's just fanatical. It's crazy. This doesn't make any sense. Brothers and sisters, the reason it doesn't make any sense to you is because you're entrenched in the world. You're right about one thing. It does not make sense to the worldly minded. Because God's principles, clearly according to what we just saw, are alien to this world. Because when the angel told the messenger of the Lord to look for God's people, she could not find them in this world. They were outside of its atmosphere. We are being governed by principles that are alien to planet Earth. Brethren, you don't want to hear.
Amen.
Let me tell you something.
Amen.
If you don't adopt the alien principles, when the alien invasion comes, you're going to have a problem. Because God's kingdom is not of this world.
Amen.
It's alien. It is foreign. We're told that very shortly from now, those who will truly be Seventh-day Adventists by our own brethren will be called fanatics, straight-laced, and extremists will sign me up at the top of the list. Because Jesus was a fanatic. He was straight-laced and an extremist. Didn't you hear what the brother presented earlier? When his own brothers would come to him and try to get him into trouble, a child, they would say, come on, man. Let's go throw some rocks at this dog. Jesus would say, it is written, Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By giving heed thereto, according to thy word.
Amen.
They said, this brother is a fanatic. Because Jesus was a fanatic, we have salvation.
Amen.
God is trying to raise up a movement that is going to declare the salvation of the Lord to a world that is entrenched in sin. Brothers and sisters, we must come up to the standard. And how do we do it? By keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus.
Amen.
Why is this important to us? Brothers and sisters, if you look back in Revelation chapter 6, you will notice that the very last thing you see in Revelation chapter 6 prior to the events that foreshadow the second coming of Jesus Christ is the shaking of the fig tree. Are you listening to me? The shaking of the fig tree. What is that fig tree dealing with? It's dealing with the investigating of God's church. Brothers and sisters, from the year 1844, God begun this work. And it didn't stop. The doctrine was so mighty back then, it was powerful enough to develop a group of 50,000 and dwindle it all the way down to 50. It was powerful enough to cause a moral fall of the churches that constituted Babylon, and the second angel's message didn't even go in all of its power. Didn't you learn that earlier? Brethren, did you learn that earlier? The first angel's message went with a loud cry. Third angel's message goes with the? The second angel's message just went, and it still was able to bring about a group of 50,000 and dwindle it down to 50. Cause a moral downfall of all the churches in America. It didn't even go in all of its power. But the message is getting ready to go again. Not with some of the power of the Spirit of God, but the full outpouring of the Spirit of God that is spoken of in Revelation chapter 18, beginning at verse 1. Brothers and sisters, when the loud cry of Revelation chapter 18 goes forward, declaring the final fall of Babylon, if it was powerful enough to shake the world when it was first proclaimed without the fullness of the Spirit of God, what is it going to do then? What is it going to do to over 1 billion plus Catholics? What is it going to do to over 1 billion plus Muslims? How many are evangelicals? What will it do to a Seventh-day Adventist church that numbers some, how much now? 14, 16, what is it now? 18 million? What will it do, brothers and sisters? That's when the number of 144,000 starts looking like a big number. And not a small number anymore. Brethren, that's what we're living in right now. That is the time we're living in now. The message you heard earlier is the message of relevance for this hour. We are living during the investigative judgment. And if we do not embrace the work of the cleansing of the soul temple now, I guarantee you, as God cut off a people in times past, he will cut you off the same way. With tears in his eyes, but he will cut you off. It's not that God wants any man to perish. God is tired of being separated from his people. The untimely figs are getting ready to be shaken out of Zion. You know what untimely figs are? Fruit that tries to ripen when the harvest is over. The harvest is past. The summer is ended. I pray that none of our souls will be lost in that hour. This is why The Bible makes this statement in the book of Daniel chapter 8 as we close. Daniel chapter 8. In Daniel the 8th chapter. Daniel the 8th chapter, beginning at verse 13. Brothers and sisters, we need to know from whence we came. If we don't know how we came about, we don't even know where we're going. That is why this church has ceased to be a movement. Because we don't even understand how we came into existence. This is the church of Bible prophecy. That God has risen up to bring this world to an end. The Bible says in the book of Daniel chapter 8 and verse 13. Then I heard one saint speaking, and another saint said unto the certain saint which spake, how long shall be the vision concerning the day and the transgression of desolation? I left out sacrifice purposely. The transgression of desolation, to give both the sanctuary and the host to be trodden underfoot. In simple language, the saint was saying to the other saint, the wonderful number, Jesus Christ, Lord, how long are you going to allow paganism and all of this apostate Christianity? How long are you going to allow these powers to lead people to Christless graves? To mar your truth, to deceive people and allow them to believe lies that will lead them into damnation? How long will you allow these powers to have authority on planet Earth? But the wonderful number, Jesus Christ himself, responds in verse 14, the very pillar for which you are here right now. And he said unto me, until 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Don't you get it? Don't you understand the response from Jesus? The saint was asking, how long are you going to allow these powers to reign, destroy your people, mar your truth? But Jesus says, when I cleanse my sanctuary, then I can deal with the rebels. God has to deal with sin in the church before he can put down the apostate powers. We are the object of God's sincerest interest. God has no problem with taking vengeance on the papal power and every other agency of Babylon. His problem is getting Babylon out of our hearts. He's trying to cleanse his sanctuary. How long are we going to continue to allow Jesus Christ to wait to receive to himself what he deserves and owns through the purchase of his own blood? Brothers and sisters, as Jesus came to the fig tree in times of old, I want you to know Jesus is at the fig tree now, and he's hungry. Come on now, brothers and sisters. Jesus is hungry even now. You don't believe me? Go with me to Revelation chapter 3. The Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 3, you know the scripture. Revelation chapter 3, beginning at verse 20, the Bible tells us, behold, I stand at the door, and if any man hears my voice and opens up the door, I will come in and sup with him, and he with me. Jesus wants to eat. He's hungry. Now hold on a second, brothers and sisters. Jesus is hungry. He wants you to feed him. Did you hear what I said? Jesus wants you to feed him. You don't believe that? The Bible says that he's standing at the door and knocking, and if you open up, he will come in and sup with you. Now question, if I come to your house and I knock on the door, and I say, what's for dinner? Who's feeding? Come on now. Who's providing the meal? We are told in Desire of Ages, page 191, that he hungers for the sympathy and love of those that are the purchase of his blood. Are you going to feed Jesus? Are you going to sympathize with Christ? Are you going to give him the love that he deserves? We're told in Christ Object Lessons, page 298, that Christ is looking. He is hungry to receive the fruit of sympathy. Oh, matter of fact, let me pull out this phone. You know, I love technology when it suits my purposes. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, brother, Jesus is hungry. It's time for us to feed Jesus. We're told right here, Christ Object Lessons, page 298. Christ hungers to receive from his vineyard the fruit of holiness and unselfishness. He looks for the principles of love and goodness. Are you ready to feed Jesus? He's hungry. What is your decision this evening? Every head bowed and every eye closed. I have two simple appeals I'd like to make. Then I'll close in prayer. We are truly living during the time period in which this message is not waning in power, but it's growing in force. And it is swelling into a loud cry. And if we continue to harden our hearts, brothers and sisters, there will be no hope for us. God is making his final call to the inhabitants of earth to make our calling and our election sure. But to us as God's people, to whom much is given, much shall be required. If it is your desire this evening to say, Lord, I realize that if you were to search me this evening, I would be weighed in the balances and found wanting. I want to recommit my heart totally to your service. No more games, no more playing. By the might of your spirit, if you give me your grace, when I leave from this place, even now, Lord, I am committed to following in all the light that you have been so gracious to show to me. If it is your desire to make this commitment to the Lord this evening, I want to invite you to come down front here with me. I'd like to have a word of prayer with you. Because, brothers and sisters, this is a time of refreshing. In all honesty, now we need to make a final stand for the truth. I make one more appeal and then I'll close in prayer. My final appeal is to anyone here that may have never received Christ into their heart as Lord and Savior. And if you, as you've heard about the three angels' messages, the everlasting gospel, which is to bring this world to an end, and the fact that even now Christ is searching for a people that are receiving these messages into their hearts. If it is your desire to say this evening, Lord, I want you to be the Lord of my life. I want to be amongst that number. I want to commit myself to your service. If you have not committed yourself, if you have not surrendered your heart to the service of Jesus Christ, I just invite you to raise your hand wherever you're at. If there's anyone here like that this evening, that would like to say, Lord, I give you my heart. Without any further ado, let's close in prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, there's no new message. There is no new message. For you said it's the everlasting gospel. And here we are, a people that have been so blessed to have the Bible and the spirit of prophecy in our midst. We have all the truth that we could possibly need. so that the way into the city is clear. Even as you did for the shepherds at the first advent of Christ. Yes, the Magi, they studied and they had an understanding that the Messiah was born. But for the Magi, you sent the angels to them and told them where the babe would be and in what fashion they would find the babe. There was no shadow of doubt in their mind because the gift of prophecy was given unto them. You've done that for us. You've given us all the particulars so that we cannot have any shadow of doubt within our minds as to where we are now in the train of Earth's history. And we come to commit ourselves to your service, Lord, because we have not been faithful to the truth. Like the fig tree, Father, we flaunt leaves. We have a form of godliness, but we deny the power of your Spirit. But Lord, we're asking, grant us of your Spirit. Fill us with your Spirit so that when our names do come up in the Lamb's Book of Life, we will be found hidden in Jesus Christ. Thank you for hearing our prayers. Seal up our decisions in your court. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless.
Jesus, blessed Jesus, hear, O Lord.